Hi, this is Stu, and of course we're at the beautiful Purple Valley. And today I'm here with Greg Nardi. Welcome, Greg.
Thank you.
Before we started, I thought I'd start with a little disclaimer, because of course today, Greg is a little bit of a philosophy expert, of which I am severely challenged. Some of you may know already that of course I am maybe considered a little bit almost supernatural with my appreciation of anatomy and yoga. But when it comes to philosophy, there is a big gaping hole. So do forgive me if some of my questions upset anybody or cause discomfort. Think of me more as like childlike in my appreciation of philosophy. So Greg, let's start with like a really simple question. Like, what is yoga?
Right.
In fact, maybe let me rephrase it to make it even more specific. We could say, take me as an example. I practice asana every day almost, but I don't meditate, I don't do pranayama, I'm not a vegetarian, and I don't believe in God.
Mm.
So am I a yogi? Am I a, can I call myself a yoga practitioner?
Possibly.
Possibly?
Yeah. So it is not a simple question, what is yoga? Because of course so many people practice yoga and they have different motivations for why they practice yoga. So I think the motivation has a lot to do with what yoga is and what is yoga to you. So while we might think of yoga as sort of a unified whole, we can really think that there just are a bunch of yogas. The easy answer would be just to refer back to Patanjali in the Yoga Sutras and say yoga chitta vritti nirodha, which means yoga is the sort of restriction of mental thoughts, of mental machinations. But we know that, of course, Pattabhi Joyce is very famous for saying yoga is 99% practice, 1% theory. And so really, I think what we can think of yoga as a body of techniques that have been shared amongst many traditions and many peoples over a long period of time that have been passed down through sort of lineages from teacher to student.
And when you say techniques, you don't just mean asana techniques, you mean techniques of working with the body like meditation, pranayama, that sort of thing?
Yeah, yeah, techniques, you know, really classically, if we look back, there's many types of yoga and not all of them even have an asana practice associated with them. So there's bhakti yoga, the yoga of devotion. There is jnana yoga, the yoga of sort of learning how to use the mind to discern. Karma yoga, the yoga of action, right? So many different types of yoga. Asana was primarily in the Patanjali period, a seat for meditation.
Mm-hmm.
And then we see subsequent development of sort of an encyclopedia of different asanas and with therapeutic purposes associated with them and these types of things. And so now, of course, we've got so many asanas. Scholars are sort of researching where do these asanas come from. There's so many ideas about where these asanas, are they ancient, are they modern, these types of things. So what really matters is that it is a body of practices, and these practices have a lot of variety in them that would be tailored to the individual based on their desire, based on their constitution, right? And so you find the practices that are effective for you. And effective to what? Well, that depends on...
I was going to say. Yes.
Yeah, effective to your goals,
right?
But ideally, what if for me, if it's going to qualify as yoga, it should be about learning how to turn your attention inward. And so, ideally, asana practice is really just a process of discovery about what is the best way for you to thrive in your body.
Does there need to be something greater than that too, though? Oh yeah, turn it in, but to also a greater purpose for the good of all mankind, or purely a selfish, in some way selfish, we could think of understanding myself, but to what, does the objective matter?
I mean, everybody's got their starting point, right? And I think that the more that we begin to study the self, and if we really practice according to a method, right? So I think that to me is what really matters is that, that we pick techniques that are useful and that we commit to them. Mm-hmm. And then what will happen is that just begins us on a journey of self-discovery. So if you begin desiring just to become healthier, that's fine. But what you'll find is that in order to become healthy, you need to become healthy in, you know, body and mind, perhaps. What we start to realize is perhaps then there is an interdependence between us and the world, right? Yeah. And so health can start to take on a bigger meaning than just my physical health or my mental health or the ability to be successful in life. All of a sudden, we might see that there's overlap between our health and the health of the world that we're living in.
Yeah.
So yeah, it can take you on quite a journey.
It grows from that. And I think a lot of people find that they start yoga for a particular, or the physical practice of yoga for a particular reason, yeah. And that changes over time, and they develop or whatever. But a lot of people think that maybe in the society at the moment, where there's such a focus on the physical asana practice, that is sort of eroding the qualities of the more unified view of yoga. Do you see that?
I don't necessarily know that it's the overemphasis on asana per se, but I do think that there is some problems with what we're taught to believe about asana, or uh-huh. what is the purpose of asana. So I oftentimes, you know, say when we come to this practice, we bring our conditioning with us, right? And as moderns, we are very highly conditioned to achieve, to succeed, these types of things. And so we tend to think of yoga as this sort of process of acquisition, like we want to get more asanas, we want to have new experiences. And so it is this whole, and it becomes performative and this kind of stuff. So then all of a sudden, yeah, we're just using the asana practice, we're calling it yoga, but really we're just, you know, going by our conditioning.
Yeah.
But I think that the asana practice has the ability to help us face our conditioning. Because at some moment in your asana practice, if you're really doing it in a disciplined fashion, that paradigm begins to break down on us.
Yeah.
We find that we can't achieve something we want to achieve. We can't succeed in ways that we would like to. And it's like at that moment where it kind of brings us to our knees a little bit, we learn to surrender and entertain the possibility that we can maybe approach this differently. And I think that's the big moment where the yoga begins. So no, I don't think the problem is necessarily asana per se, or the overemphasis on asana, but certainly maybe the commercialization of asana as a form of entertainment and these types of things.
Entertainment, exercise.
Yeah, it'll make wellness. You healthy, and that's yeah. always a good thing.
yeah.
You
yeah.
know what I mean? But of course, there is something else that's possible there if you're really kind of trying to do it in a disciplined fashion. So it's not just about what we do, but also how we do it. I think that matters.
Do you think it's possible to reflect inwards if we have, say, other distractions like music, like conditioning within the physical practice? Do you think that's still possible to contemplate it as yoga when we add other layers on like that?
So it really depends on your starting point, right? So if you're used to a lot of distraction, as we are in the modern world, going into a studio where there's, you know, like we have a studio at home, and there's no mirrors, there's no music, you know, just a blank room with a small altar in the front, and everybody practices facing in one direction. And we found that some people come in, and when we tell them that that's what we do, they're like, that sounds like my worst nightmare.
Yeah, right? Freak, yeah.
Yeah, so they're not ready for that, clearly. So right. A little bit of music, a little bit of, you know, might get them,
yeah.
You know, at least it's better than the constant checking the phone and the, you know, distractions that might happen in the outer world.
Right.
It's a little less distracted. But ultimately, I think we want to move towards greater silence.
Yeah.
You know, if we think about the eight-limbed path, Ashtanga means eight limbs, you know, it goes from very sort of gross and external to very subtle and internal. So we eventually come to the point where the the more subtle practices are really just sitting in silence and turning your attention inward. So that is kind of the progression. But you have to start where you are. You know, there's you can't say like, I'm only a yogi if, or I'm only a yogi when. You know, you start right now, you do one thing to make yourself better, you know, and then you let it build from there.
Is there a checklist that people could think about what they're getting out of their practice that may make them consider, am I really self-reflecting? Am I really on the path, or am I just having a play?
A checklist. I mean, I think it becomes obvious when it's happening. You know, I think we all have good days and bad days in yoga. There's sort of currents and countercurrents, but generally you want to feel like you're thriving, you're happier, you're better as a result of your yoga practice. Your life is a little easier from your yoga practice. If you're constantly suffering through your yoga practice, that's probably not such a great thing either, right? You might want to reflect on that a little bit. But generally, I think that you know, it should just be that feeling that this is working for you, that your life is better as a result. And I think that's obvious.
A lot of people feel that by doing the physical practice, they are becoming more spiritual, whatever spiritual might mean for the individual. Do you feel that is possible without the extra work, or does it creep? Is the concept that it creeps up on you and then you take new steps?
I mean, yeah, you know, it comes down to that spiritual whatever that means, right? So I think that these are very subjective statements about spirituality. So it's really up to the individual to decide whether or not they want to call the experiences that they are having spiritual experiences or not. But generally, if you feel that there's more contentment in your life, if you find that your stress is less, if you find that you're more capable of dealing, interacting in the world, to me, that is spiritual. You know what I mean? So this is, you don't have to sort of put on a garb to be considered spiritual. You don't need a mala bead and a dhoti to be spiritual.
Oh, I mean, throw them away then.
Well, yeah, exactly. Exactly. So yeah, it's to me, being spiritual is being authentic.
Right, yeah. And you mentioned earlier, you were talking about, you touched on it, whether the postures that we now use in modern, what we could call modern yoga, how far back they come from, whether they were 2,000 years old, whether they're 70, 80 years old. What's your, and some of the work of Mark Singleton and some of the other authors that have sort of highlighted those ideas about maybe coming from contortionism, some of them, and that sort of stuff. What are your own feelings on that sort of thing?
It's a tough question. I don't think we'll ever fully know. I think that there was, you know, a very good point that was brought up by some of this recent sort of scholarship that I think is useful, and that is to understand that yoga traditions evolve and that there have been many influences. But you got to remember that a lot of what we have, you know, we have sort of the textual record, we have the archaeological record. We're not quite sure how those two interact with each other.
Right.
We have these sort of 5,000-year-old Pashupati seals from this Indus Valley civilization of people sitting in what could be a yoga pose, what could be a modern person projecting onto an image that it is a yoga pose.
Right.
We don't know. We have pictures from magazines of people doing Swedish gymnastics, doing things that look like modern yoga poses, so we make a relationship there. So it's a murky to kind of know, but I had the reason why we want to know, I think, is very important. And I had a teacher, and we were sort of asking about this Yoga Karunta, right? This sort of famous text that nobody has sort of seen in modern times because it's been eaten by ants. Pattabhi Joyce and Krishnamacharya would say that this was the origin of the Ashtanga yoga sequences, yeah. But we don't have any copies of it. So some people call bunk on that, right? Yeah. So I was asking my teacher about it, one of my philosophy teachers, and he said, you Westerners, he said, you always are interested in what's old. He said, in India, we're interested in what's effective.
Yes.
Right? So I thought, okay, that changes it a little bit. So then my question is not sort of looking for validation for my practices because it's old, trying to get some sort of sense that there's an authority because of its antiquity. Mm. Rather, is it working?
Yeah.
And yes, it's working for me, and I think it's working for many people around the world. It doesn't work for everybody, but it's working. And to me, that's what really matters. What I can say about the larger framework, though, is that the Indian tradition and the yoga tradition are largely syncretic in nature. So when when we look at that trend in sort of yogic thought or in Eastern thought, that there have always been sort of variegated streams of thought and practice that then get sort of synthesized into a single stream, and then they variegate again, and this happens over and over again. When we think about the colonial period and the fact that that had such a deep impact on India, it makes sense that they would try to synthesize the best of what they were experiencing, right?
Yes.
So in modern times, as we're trying to sort of have a renaissance of yoga and, Indian traditions, that also it seemed very natural, because it is a very Indian tradition, to synthesize the best of what's happening around you.
Yeah.
So tradition is not, in my mind, unchanging. Tradition is just an orientation of looking backwards while moving forwards.
But there's some amount of weight that is given to something that is old, that survives, because you think, well, it's been tested for these thousands of years, like a clinical trial almost, over an extended period. And if it's still around, then it must really be working, because you've generations, generations. Whereas something that is relatively newly adopted doesn't have the same weight being tested and tried.
But this is what traditions are. It's a system of checks and balances, right? So if, because we can also look back into things that are traditional that are not so very useful for us today. You know what I mean? Just because it's old doesn't mean that we should be doing it now. It's got to make sense for the times in which we also find ourselves. So, people who are saying, oh, well, it's traditional, so therefore, there's a lot of traditional things that I would challenge those people to do, right? But what tradition does is, I think as moderns in the West, we're very cued into this idea of progress, and progress always being a good thing, but also we know that progress for progress's sake is not always good.
Yeah.
It can cause chaos, it can, cause all sorts of conflict and disharmony. So what tradition does for us is it collects the best of wisdom, and then we don't make changes without purpose. In other words, we kind of wash it against the tradition to see if it holds up, and then the best of the traditions move forward. And of course, if a tradition is to stay relevant and alive, then those things that aren't so useful also fall away.
Is there some things that you can think of that have fallen away in the past however many decades that could give us an example of something that was prevalent or was useful at that time and no longer done anymore?
In the Ashtanga tradition?
Yeah, maybe in the Ashtanga.
Oh, now you're getting me in trouble.
Okay.
I've been practicing since 1999, going to Mysore. I've been practicing since longer than that, but that's when I started going to Mysore. I've seen the system change in very, very minor ways here and there, just like, a hand placement here or a gaze there, something like that. But there seems to be that there was a moment where things really shifted from sort of that first wave of teachers to, as things started to grow.
Yeah.
And I think that as things grow, then you need more order, And so things tend to get more codified. but I think that things sometimes get a bit rigid and they lose the individualism at times today. Yeah. In the yoga practice. So the ability to really, you know, stick to the tradition but use skillful means to meet the individual. I think that Guruji was excellent at that. Even as long as I knew him and worked with him, people were already having these ideas of this sort of rigidly codified system, but I would watch Guruji, you know, sort of bend the rules for different individuals all the time, and I thought that was a really beautiful thing, and I hope that that continues. I think Sharad is doing that as well.
Because that's something that people question, is it? That, you know, we have teachers that say, well, Guruji told me to do it this way, and then somebody else, Guruji told me to do it this way, and they're like different, which is what you would expect if you were treating each person as an individual, which is fantastic. But there is very much, you know, in certain circles, a drive to, this is a tradition, this is how you do it, and this is the way.
Yeah. People want that holy grail. People love certainty. Certainty makes us feel comfortable, but, you know, you have to sometimes live in the gray areas, and if you want to really, you know, progress and grow, right? Like, you've got to step out of the known, you've got to step out of the certain. But when you're new to the practice, you know, the rules are useful because it gives you an idea of what you're doing. It gives you some boundaries.
Yeah, the guidelines.
But eventually, I think you need to, you know, sort of develop the what's called viveka, this discernment, this you know, insight, so that you can begin to know, well, is what I'm doing actually the best thing for me to do right now, you know? And then I think that you can have you can make sort of wise choices around your practice. You know, we all have this sort of duality in us. Sometimes, you know, we can bend the rules because it's really what's healthiest for us, but sometimes we bend the rules because we're being lazy, right?
Yeah.
So developing that real kind of skill of knowing which is which is not always easy.
And we've mentioned tradition a few times just in the last few minutes. And some people would question, potentially, if Ashtanga really is only 80 years old, has it been going long enough to be considered to have traditions?
Well, yeah, does the Yoga Karanta exist or not? but I think that this was, you know, there was this moment where, you know, Guruji called this the Ashtanga Yoga Research Institute, right? And so there was this sort of feeling of trying to really look into, you know, there is this body of practices, but then sort of how do we really verify or you know, what their meaning and what their effect is. And so there was all this kind of scientific research, because what we've got are these, you know, pre-modern texts that talk about chakras and prana and things that, you know, it's very difficult to subject that to scientific study, right?
Yeah.
Because it's a subjective statement of a physical experience. So now it's kind of up to us to verify that in a language that we're more comfortable with in modern times. And I think that's what the Modern Yoga Project has been about. So when Guruji was doing this, he called it the Ashtanga Yoga Research Institute. We've seen that he's made little changes. For instance, you know, from what I hear, they used to practice, you know, they used to move more quickly through the sequence. They used to practice multiple times a day. They used to practice every day. They learned pranayama very quickly, you know, these types of things. And I think that as time has gone on, Guruji has kind of made these changes as he's learned, you know, and I think that's fair enough, you know, and I hope the research never ends.
Yeah, I mean, there's still changes going on now, isn't there? And we mentioned something off camera. Can you explain, because I even have trouble with that, what we mean when we say parampara?
Yeah, parampara. So this is a word that sort of has gotten more traction in the last several years. So it literally means like a succession, right? Or things in a line. And it tends to mean, you know, in the yoga shishya, guru-shishya relationship. So how sort of teachings particularly are transmitted from a guru to a disciple.
Yeah.
And this was something that when Guruji was aging and Sharat was sort of getting set to become the main teacher at the institute in Mysore, that this word started coming around a lot, parampara, and it was sort of to legitimize, I think, Sharat as the next lineage holder.
Yeah.
And some people then have this question like, oh, is this dynastic? You know what I mean? And,
can
and
only
is this
be
really
in
fair?
The family.
But that's not really the idea of it. It wasn't always just that it passed through family. But the Guru Shishya sort of tradition, which is an Indian tradition, was that you would go and you would live with your guru as a family member.
Uh-huh.
And so the only three people that I really can say who are alive today who have done that are Saraswati and Sharat and Manju. Mm. Right? So, you know, you can see some validity, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it has to pass through a family line. It just usually does.
Yeah.
But I think that the really good thing about it is, and this is something that I really hold in such high regard in Ashtanga Yoga, is that we have maintained this idea that teachings are meant to be passed through transmission, through close contact with the teacher over a long period of time. You know, no 200-hour yoga teacher trainings, yeah. You know, this kind of stuff. It's something that you can't just sort of fulfill a curriculum and say then that you are done.
Mm.
You know, you have to just spend a long time refining your craft with the support of your teachers, you know, being around your teachers, them sort of saying, yeah, that's good, but no, maybe you need more work here. And, you know, and so there is this more of an apprenticeship style. And I think that we've got that part right, you know.
Yeah, that sounds good to me. I really like apprenticeship type ideas. Yeah. But there's always been a question of just because you can do, so traditionally it's been, it has been such that you went to Mysore so many months a year, it's when your practice became of a certain level, you became certified, authorized, whatever. I mean, that's probably grossly simplifying it. But just because you can do doesn't necessarily make you a good teacher.
Agreed. I think that when you get your authorization, it has just said that you have gone through the period of practicing for a number of years and that you've gotten to a certain level of proficiency in the series. You at least would know the order of the poses and you know how they're supposed to look. But no, it doesn't make you a good teacher. Yeah. I think in this idea of parampara, that you also teach with your teacher for a long time.
Yeah.
This is something that I think Sharad is trying to address more and more. So now he has, once you're authorized, that you spend time with him in the shala and he's watching you to adjust.
Mm.
He's now started these sort of teachers' courses where only teachers go for 2 months in the summer and, you know, are working on their teaching skills. So I think he is making movements in that direction. But again, this is how things do evolve and change. I don't think that just having a piece of paper saying you've been to India 4 times is sufficient to say you're a teacher, but it is a good standard, at least, you know, a good start point to begin.
And so on that topic of teachers, you know, what do you see the role of if you're going to call yourself a yoga teacher, what roles do you see that as embodying?
Yeah, so maybe you're a guide a little bit, you're a partner kind of, you know, so there is, this is one of those things that when we get newly authorized, we have this piece of paper that says we have authority. And, you know, many, you know, I watched the way that Guruji taught and, you know, and there was sort of this very sort of authoritarian approach. And so sometimes we think that, you know, we're meant to mimic that as teachers. And I did that for a long time as a new teacher, trying to be that. And that's just not who I am.
Yeah.
And I had to come to terms with that, you know. And so what I do is I you know, meet my students and I try to know as much as I can about them. And I explain to them what this system is. And then we work together to move them along in the system. You know, so whether that be through hands-on adjustments, whether that be through, you know, me finding the right words to inspire or encourage them, you know, but I definitely think that students learn best through inspiration. Mm. You know what I mean? And so maybe that's my role, is to just kind of keep this space and hold on to this vision of what this lineage holds, and do my best to encourage the students to get with it.
Yeah.
And simply because, you know, like, because I believe that this lineage offers a tremendous amount. So it's not like I'm trying to sell it. You know, it's changed me. It's a beautiful thing. And I think by sharing it with other people, they will also get benefit from it. So it's not compulsory. It's by the student's choice, you know.
Yeah. If I sort of hark back to the changes that are going on with the practice, I mean, two things really. One, the first thing is, how much do you feel that you can alter, modify the practice as a practitioner or a teacher, and still feel that you're actually within the tradition? You know,
Maybe you can answer that question.
Yeah, I mean, people who've seen me practice know that I add bits in, I take bits out, but I still consider myself an Ashtanga practitioner. But there would be those that said, what the hell are you doing?
Yeah.
You know.
Well, again, it's a personal journey inward, right? So we have these sort of rules, and we have this sort of, you know, progression of poses and things like that. And there is a real logic to that series of poses. Mm. And it's when it's followed, there's something really wonderful that transpires. But there are times where perhaps there's some modification that's called for. Mm. I've done it in my own practice. So if there's injury, if I'm, you know, just traveling a lot or busy in my life, or, you know, there's other things going on, and I find that I can't hold the energy of the whole practice done in the specific way every day, well, it's better for me to find a practice that I can do every day than to not practice. Mm. You know what I mean? Because when I'm trying to force myself to follow the rules when it's not appropriate, then it's making a very negative association between me and my practice. And so that ultimately goes nowhere good, right?
Yeah.
So you have to find, you know, a way to practice appropriately. But you also have to wonder, why am I modifying, right? So have I made intelligent choices around my modifications? So am I modifying because I'd, you know, just want to do what's good for me, or what's easy for me, or what I like to do, and avoid what I don't like to do, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes people modify for that reason. Am I modifying out of fear? You know, so there's a lot of reasons why we might sort of slice and dice the series a little bit. And that's something that really only you know. This is why a teacher is really important. So you have a partner to kind of talk these things over with, that maybe they can, you know, they can support you to try something that you wouldn't normally want to do on your own. Make it a little safer for you, so that when you do it, you're like, okay, I think I can do this if you're there, you know? Then it's okay. So it always comes down to, why are you doing these modifications? If you've got a congenital condition, or a, you know, one leg is shorter than the other, you know, yeah.
You can say one leg.
Well, perhaps.
Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah,
perhaps, right? I mean, then you need to modify. And nobody would say that person's not an Ashtangi.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
So on the other end of things, something that sort of bugs me, maybe I don't, as much as I'm willing to change something myself, I also don't really like it being changed from above, which is a bit sort of bonkers, I suppose, really. But the way I sense the changes that are happening to the practice, it seems to be they're making the practice shorter all the time. There's more things being taken out than things being put in, and that like the lead primary that Sharat does now is like, is it only just over an hour or something like that? Okay. And I wonder how much of that is, this is probably close to heresy, how much of it is commercially based. In other words, the quicker we get people in and out, the quicker we get the next batch in. You know, that's the sort of the feeling I get.
Yeah, I think there's probably some of that is true. I can't speak to Sharat's motivations. I don't know.
Of course not.
But I probably get that sense as well. I don't know that I would call it commercially based necessarily, though, as much as, you know, I really do feel, I think that he believes in this as a bit of a sort of a movement, and that he wants to make as much access to as many people as possible. And it's becoming harder and harder. You know, there are now hundreds of people who are applying, who don't get in, who, you know, we've made, now Schrott's made rules about who's even qualified to apply for the Shala, and that was like a big to-do. So it's really hard to please everybody all the time, you know what I mean? And I think that there is some truth to what you're saying. A lot of it is to get people in, get people out. You know, Shavasana is like you lay down, and he's like, okay, thank you, get out the door, you know?
I was going to swear, but I won't.
What the
heck? I was going to swear, but I won't.
Yeah. So this happens, but I think that by and large, when I am in Mysore, I practice a certain way, and then when I'm home and I have the time and I have the space, then I take a little longer with my practice and, you know, and that kind of a thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Hmm. So if we, I mean, there's a lot of people out there that they do the physical practice, like myself, and then they want to go to start trying to absorb more of the other qualities and more philosophical sort of ideas. And so what would be some good things for them to start with, either text-wise or practice-wise, or just to get people on the road to expanding away from purely just the physical practice?
Yeah. I would say if you can sit a little bit every day, that's a really great practice. So oftentimes what I will do, and I really like mantra, and you know, but everybody's got their own affinities. Some people hate to sit, some people hate chanting, you know, but find something that you have an affinity for. And what I usually do is I begin my practice each day where I will say some mantras, or I will sit, I will do my full asana practice, and then I will spend a little bit of time after my practice doing some breathing techniques or something like that. So I just kind of build it in on either end, and then, you know, sort of let it expand from there.
Do you have a benefit, because you guys, I say you guys, because I'm outside getting ready, doing my free yoga, and but you guys sit before practice, whereas for me, I'm just not ready to be sitting down before I start. I need to move. And then I feel calm enough at the end to, that would be when I would do meditation or whatever, because I've burnt off some energy and my body is open, it's comfortable for sitting. So do you have a preference? I know we're doing it here beforehand. Is that how you would do it at home? And if so, what for what reason?
Well, I just find that like first thing in the morning that your mind is quiet. So, you know, physically it's harder to sit, but mentally it's easier to sit. It's sort of like whether you do your asana practice first thing in the morning or at the end of the day. You're more open at the end of the day, of course.
Yeah.
But sitting isn't necessarily just about sitting and being just completely comfortable all the time. It's about, you know, trying to maintain a focal point for a period of time, even amidst distractions, whether those are physical distractions, whether it's the rooster crowing or the Hindi music playing out in the yard, you know, whatever types of things are trying to take your attention, that you, for that period of time, give yourself the discipline not to react, but just to sit and stay with your focal point. So it is a, you know, while we oftentimes think of meditation as this sort of relaxing thing, it's not. It's a discipline, and it requires some effort, some will. So,
do so.
Yeah.
And what about text-wise? Is there something that you could really say, well, if you wanted to understand a little bit more about the sutras or a little bit more about the origins, or what would you say would be a nice starter?
Yeah, I mean, I read the Yoga Sutra seems to be the one that I've connected with the most, probably because of its prevalence in modern yoga.
Is there a nice translation?
There is. It's called The Essence of Yoga. I might be saying the last name wrong, but I think it's Bernard Bouchard. He was a student of Deskachars. And the reason why I particularly like that one is because before each sutra, he gives questions for reflection, and so the idea is that you can consider how does the sutra, how is it relevant for my life?
Yeah.
So I find that very useful. If you want to dig a little bit deeper, Edwin Bryant does an excellent version of the Yoga Sutras. It's more academic in nature, but it's very comprehensive and does a really good job. So those two I usually recommend depending on the level of the student.
Cool.
Just a fair warning, when I asked Patavi Joyce if I should read the Yoga Sutras, he said, no, you'll just confuse yourself.
Interesting, yeah.
But interestingly, he then recommended that I read three pre-modern Hatha Yoga texts. So some people say that Ashtanga Yoga is not a system of Hatha Yoga, but from my experience with Patavi Joyce, it very clearly is, because that was what he recommended that I study.
Yeah.
And then also I said, okay, I'll read those. And what about the Bhagavad Gita? He said, oh, if you haven't read the Bhagavad Gita, read that first.
Ah, okay. So, that so was there we go. That's number one. Read that one.
Yeah, there you go.
Glad we got that. Thanks so much, Greg. And I hope I haven't asked too many awkward questions.
It's great. And, you've got to be willing to go there, right?
Yeah, exactly. Cool. Hope you enjoyed that, guys.